Hello everyone, welcome back to Panita Science World. Students, in today's video lesson, we are going to talk about coordination in plants, right? Students, we see plants all around us, but are they of the same size or height? Of course not. We see big trees, medium-sized shrubs, and even plant saplings. This tells us that plant shows some growth changes as well as some movement. This coordination in plant is attributed to the presence of plant hormones. Just because of plant hormones, which is basically known as phytohormones. Clear? Unlike animals, plants do not have any muscular system or nervous system, but they are still able to show movement and coordinate. And this is just because of phytohormones or the plant hormones. Clear? Despite not having sense organs, plants also sense things and respond to them. Plants respond to various of things like light, gravity, touch, water, etc. Clear? So basically, these are called environmental stimuli. Okay, so these stimuli are called environmental stimuli. Clear? Okay, so what actually happens? Plants coordinate their behavior by using their hormones and respond to the environmental changes. Okay. And this they do by affecting the growth of a plant. So students, in today's video, we are just going to focus on coordination in plants, right? So as you see in the picture that I have mentioned you all the detail of the coordination. So basically, coordination refers to ordered working, okay? So it refers to ordered working of different parts of plant together smoothly and efficiently. Okay. Since the nervous system does not exist in plants, they use a chemical system. Plants coordinate their behavior against environmental changes or stimuli with the help of hormones. Plants have various hormones that help them to coordinate growth and response to the environment. Clear? So if we talk about those chemicals, those chemicals are called phytohormones. Or in general, we call it plant hormone. Clear? And they play major role in plant coordination. Fine? So students, in today's video, we will just focus on the movement by the plants in response to different stimuli. And in the next part, we will discuss plant hormone. Clear? So let's move further. So now we are going to talk about the movement in plants. So basically, there are two types of movement in plants. The first is growth dependent movement, which is also known as tropic movement. Okay, so in tropic movement, the growth is actually towards or away from a stimulus. Okay, whereas in second type, the non-growth dependent, the movement are independent of stimulus, and these are also known as nestic movements. Clear? So let us first talk about the growth dependent movement or the tropic movement. So we divide tropic movement into five types. Okay. So the first is phototropism, where the movement occurs in presence of light stimulus. Geotropism, where movement occur in presence of gravity. So here the stimulus is gravity. In hydrotropism, the stimulus is water. In chemotropism, the stimulus is certain chemicals. Okay, in sigmotropism, the stimulus is touch. Okay, so we are going to discuss now these five one by one. So let's first discuss the phototropism. Fine. Well, phototropism is the growth of an organism in response to a light stimulus. That simply means here the growth takes place in response to the stimulus, which we call light. Okay. In response to light, as you see in the picture, the plant is bending towards light. That simply means that here the movement of this plant is in response to this stimulus, which is light. Okay. The shoot system of the plant show this characteristic and they move towards the light. They just bend their stem, their shoot towards the light. Clear? What actually happen is, the cells on the plant that are farthest from the light have a chemical called auxin. Okay? And this is a hormone. Fine? This reacts when phototropism occurs. This causes the plant to have elongated cells. Phototropism is again of two types. Okay? Now we again divide this phototropism into two types. The first is positive phototropism. Okay, so here when growth occurs towards light. Okay, so when growth of a plant occurs toward light source, we call it positive phototropism. And the second is negative phototropism, in which the growth takes place or occurs away from light. Okay, and that is why it is called negative phototropism. Clear? So the growth which basically takes place in response to light, and if the movement takes place in such situations, we call it phototropism. Clear? Now let's move to the second type, geotropism. Here the movement of a plant takes place towards the soil. Okay, that means the roots move in the direction of earth gravity. Okay, as you see in the picture, the roots are always positively geotropic because they always move in the direction of earth gravity. However, the shoot, the stem, moves in the upward direction, and that is why they are always negatively geotropic. Clear? So when the movement of plants takes place toward the soil or toward the direction of earth gravity, we call it geotropism. Clear? Fine. Now let's talk about the third type, hydrotropism. Students, when a plant moves in response to water, means when water acts as the stimulus, we call it hydrotropism. Okay? So here basically the stimulus is water. The roots of the plant move toward the water source, and so they show positive hydrotropism. Clear? So what actually happen is, this plant's growth response, in which the direction of growth is determined by a stimulus or a gradient in water concentration, we call the process hydrotropism, right? And it started by the root cap sensing water and sending a signal to the elongating part of the root. Okay? So they immediately, as you see in the picture, these roots have sensed the water source and now they are moving along the direction of this stimulus. And this kind of movement or tropism is called hydrotropism. Fine. Now let's move to the next type, hemotropism. So student, in this, the plant moves in response to chemical stimulus. Okay. So when the stimulus is some chemical, we call it hemotropism. Here the stimulus is some chemical. And the example which you usually get in the exam is the growth of pollen tube towards the ovule, as you see in the picture. So this, the movement of this pollen tube, this long elongated orange structure towards ovule. Okay. This is just because of the hemotropism. Means this is the example of hemotropism. Means this is just because of the chemical which accelerate or which impart movement towards movement in response to some chemical. Clear? So what actually happen is, there is a sugary substance which acts as a stimulus for the growth of pollen tube towards the ovule. This happens because ripe stigma in the carpel of a flower secrete a chemical substance into the style towards the ovary. This sugary substance acts as a stimulus for the pollen grain, which responds by growing a pollen tube in the downward direction, as you see in the figure, in the downward direction, right? Into the style of a carpel, and then it reaches the ovule of the flower for fertilization. So when a plant part moves, okay, in response to some chemical stimulus, we call it chemotropism. And the best known example is the growth of the pollen tube towards the ovule during fertilization. This is usually asked in exam, so this part is very important. Clear? Now let's move further. Thigmotropism. So in thigmotropism, when a plant part shows directional movement in response to the touch of an object. Here we call it thigmotropism. So what actually happens is, there are some plants which cannot stand upright on their own and they need support. And such plants are called climbing plants. Okay. And they have a special organ which we call tendril. This is the tendril. Okay. So basically the tendrils are thin thread-like growth on the stem and leaves of the climbing plant. Tendrils are very sensitive to the touch of other objects, and when tendril come in contact with any object, okay, with other object or with any object, it bend toward the object by growing towards it, okay, so as you see in the picture. It wind around the object and cling to it. This winding movement of a climbing plant is called thigmotropism. Clear? So here I have mentioned you the example, the tendrils of a plant climb towards any support which they touch. So because they are such touch sensitive, here touch is the stimulus, that is why this is called, this type of movement is called thigmotropism. Clear? Now let's talk about the nestic movement. So students, in nestic movement, the movement of a plant part, the movement takes place in response to an external stimulus in which the direction of response is not determined. That simply means they are non-directional. Okay, they do not move to the direction of the stimulus, and that is why they are called nestic movements, and sometimes we call them nesties. Clear? Fine. As you see in the picture, the touch me not plant, okay, the common name touch me not plant, okay, the botanical name is Mimosa pudica. Clear? So, in touch me not plant or in Mimosa pudica, you can easily observe that the plant responds to an external stimulus, which is basically a touch, okay? But they do not move along the direction of the stimulus, and that is why we call that the touch me not plant show a nestic kind of movement. Clear? Now we are going to discuss the nestic movement. So basically there are five nestic movements. The first is systemonestic movement. Here this is in systemonestic movement. In this type, the movement occur in response to the mechanical stimuli of touch, contact or water pressure, as you see in the picture. Okay. And the best known example is drooping of the leaves of Mimosa pudica when it gets touched. Clear? So systemonestic is the in which movement takes place in response to the mechanical stimuli like touch, contact, water pressure, etc. The best known example that examiner usually asks you in exam is of the Mimosa pudica, which immediately droop of the leaves, which immediately fold up its leaves or leaflets when it gets touched. Clear? Now let's talk about the second type, photonastic movements. So basically photo is, so as you see photonastic, here photo is light. Okay, that means here stimulus is light. So what happen, these occur, means here movement occur in response to light, but they do not follow the direction of light. Okay. And the best known example is the petals of Cestrum nocturnum. Okay. They usually open their petals at night and close during the day, as you see in the picture. Okay. So this plant, the Cestrum nocturnum, open up their petals at night. Okay. And they closes during the day. Fine. So when the movement or when some kind of response takes place in presence of light, in response to light, we call it photonastic movement. Fine. Let's move to the third type, thermonastic movement. Thermo is related with temperature. Okay, so this is related with temperature. That means when movement occur in response to the change and variation in temperature, we call it thermonastic movement. The best known example is the leaves of rhododendrons. Okay, they are winter sensitive because during winter or during low temperature, they curl up and close. Okay, during low temperature or during winter, as you see in the picture. Okay, so because they are temperature sensitive or they show response to the change and variation in temperature, we call them, such movement is called thermonastic movement. Clear? Now let's talk about the next, nyctinastic movements. Okay, so basically these nyctinastic movement is also called sleeping movement. Why? Because in this kind of movement, the plant show movement or response to a change in day and night. Okay, for example, the leaves of the leguminous plants, okay, they fold up and close the leaves in the evening and then they get open up in the morning. So that is why they follow a change in day and night pattern. Okay, and this kind of movement is called nyctinastic movement, and that is why we also call them sleeping movement. Clear? Now let's talk about the last one, thigmonastic movement. So this usually occur in response to contact of an object. Okay, and the best known example is the insectivorous leaves of Drosera or Venus flytrap. Okay, so when an insect come in contact with the leaves of Drosera, it immediately fold up its leaves. Okay, as you see in the picture. Okay, so when an insect come in contact with the Drosera leaves, it immediately closes it. Okay, and this is how they perform their nutrition also. So, okay, so here we are just going to talk about the movement. You don't have to talk about the nutrition, right? So when such movement occur, when an object or when something come in contact with Drosera or Venus flytrap, so they usually show responses, and such responses or such movement is called thigmonastic movement. Clear? I hope this is all clear to you. In the next video, we will talk about plant hormones. Okay, thank you, students.